Hello friends, my name is Tripti Mishra and I am your instructor for today. I will be discussing cybersecurity techniques part 1 with all of you. This module has been designed with an aim to introduce the learner with the various cybersecurity techniques. After going through this module, the learner shall be able to first understand the need of cybersecurity, second, understand the objectives of information security, third, understand different cybersecurity techniques, specifically authentication, antivirus, and firewall. And last, application of these cybersecurity techniques to prevent cybercrime. Now, I have a question for all of you. Is information security and cybersecurity the same thing? Actually, these terms are often misused because they are nearly synonymous. Both information security and cybersecurity are defined as the practice of defending information from unauthorized access, use, and modification or disruption. The only difference between the two disciplines is in the form of the data. While cybersecurity refers only to electronic security, information security is a broader term that encompasses all data, both physical and digital. In other words, cybersecurity involves protecting only digital data, like securing pictures that we upload on internet. Whereas information security protects not only data in motion, but also data at rest, like pictures stored on your phone even when not connected to the internet. Thus, cybersecurity is just a subset of information security. Remember this. Need of cybersecurity. First of all, you should understand the meaning and need of security. When we talk about the protection of computer hardware and software from any accidental or malicious access, use, modification, destruction, it is termed as security. The advent of internet has made cybersecurity an important aspect in today's world. The biggest challenge today is to secure data from malicious programs and people with iniquitous intentions. Numerous techniques are used by organizations to secure data from intruders. For example, if you want your computer not to be used by anyone, then you will use a password to provide security to your system. Similarly, we are using different security techniques to secure the data available on internet. Now tell me, what are the pillars of information security? Information security rests on three main pillars: confidentiality, integrity, and availability. These three pillars form what is often referred to as the CIA triad. The three concepts embody the fundamental security objectives for both data and for information and computing surfaces. FIPS PUB 199 provides a useful characterization of these three objectives in terms of requirements and the definition of a loss of security in each category. Confidentiality covers both data confidentiality and privacy. Integrity covers both data and system integrity. And last, availability ensures timely and reliable access to and use of information. Confidentiality, integrity, and availability are the three main objectives of information security. First is confidentiality. It means to control or restrict access of critical or sensitive information to an individual. Loss of confidentiality is the unauthorized disclosure of information. For example, if you are sending your picture to your friend, then it should be confidential between you and your friend. If any other person is doing eavesdropping during your and your friend's communication, then it breaks the confidentiality of the message. Second is integrity. It involves protection against improper information modification or destruction. A loss of integrity is the unauthorized modification or destruction of information. For example, suppose you are sending your account number to your friend to transfer money into your account. Now, if an attacker modifies the account number and places his account number in place of yours, then the integrity of the message breaks. If your friend receives the attacker's account number, he will send the money to the attacker's account, not yours. Also, if someone was sending online money transfer for, let's say, $1,000, but the information was altered or modified in such a way that the transfer value changed to $10,000, it could be very costly for him. So the integrity of the message should also be maintained for secure transmission. Third is availability. It is ensuring timely and reliable access to and use of information. A loss of availability is the disruption of access to or use of information. For example, if you're trying to access any website, an attacker already sent multiple requests to the server, then the server of the website will not be able to process your request. That means the data is not available to the authentic or authorized user. There is an unavailability of data. Also, service disruptions in a network due to hardware failure, software failure, or power outages and system upgrades could make the system or server unavailable. So it should be kept in mind by providing security that the data should be available to the authorized user whenever required. Although the use of the CIA triad to define security objectives is well established, some in the security field feel that additional concepts are needed to present a complete picture. Four most commonly mentioned are authentication, authorization, accountability, and non-repudiation. Authentication. It is the process of verifying that the identified user is the real owner of his or her identity. For example, to access your Facebook account, you should enter valid ID and password. Your ID and password proves your authenticity. Another example can be, after swiping the ATM card, the user is supposed to enter his secret PIN. Once it is entered, the user is authenticated to perform the desired transaction. Second is authorization. It is the process of ensuring that an employee has enough access rights to a particular information so that he can perform intended actions. For example, once you enter valid credentials to your Facebook account, you are authorized to perform all that you have permission to do, like post pictures, post videos, post statuses, etc. Accountability. It focuses that for any actions taken by an entity can be traced uniquely to that entity. For example, after the user is authorized to access his account, through the credentials, he is accountable for any task that is carried out by him on his account. The last is non-repudiation. Non-repudiation is the assurance that someone cannot deny something. A legal document typically requires witnesses to signing so that the person who signs cannot deny having done so. For example, suppose you have sent a message to someone, but after a few days, you are denying that you have sent the message. In this case, the digital signature ensures non-repudiation. This will be discussed in later slides. You can understand all these objectives with one simple example. Suppose your mother kept a chocolate ice cream in the fridge for you, and your brother already has eaten his ice cream. So your mother asked you to keep your ice cream safe from your brother, otherwise he will eat yours as well. You have used lock in the fridge to keep your ice cream safe from your brother. In above scenario, your mother is the sender and you are the receiver of ice cream. The message that ice cream is kept inside the fridge is confidential between you and your mother. You are authentic user to access your ice cream. If your brother wants that ice cream, he should take permission from you or your mother to eat that. Suppose your brother got the keys of the fridge. So he is not only authentic, but even authorized to eat your ice cream now. Think that he eats all of your chocolate ice cream and keeps another flavor ice cream in its place. In this case, he is modifying or changing the content. That is, he is breaking the integrity of the content. But in all this case, who will be accountable? Of course, you, as you were supposed to keep the key of the fridge safely. Then suppose you kept the key of the fridge somewhere and forgot. So there is unavailability of data. That is, data is not available even to the authentic user. Now suppose your mother told you to keep your ice cream safe from your brother, but when your brother confronts his mother, that did she restrict him from eating his sister's ice cream? And your mother denies saying so. But if you would have already recorded your mother's statement, this would ensure non-repudiation. In that case, your mother could not deny because her statement has already been recorded. I hope this clears all the objectives of information security. So now, let us learn about various cybersecurity techniques, authentication, antivirus, and firewall. These are some methods by which we can prevent cyber crimes. We will discuss these methods one by one in detail. The first cybersecurity technique that we are going to discuss is authentication. What is authentication? Authentication is a process of identifying an individual and ensuring that the individual is the same who he or she claims to be. It is the process of ascertaining claimed user identity by verifying user-provided evidence. For example, as you can see in the image, username is required to identify who are you, and the password is required to ensure that you are the authentic user. Once you enter valid credentials, you will be authenticated. Authentication in simple term is positive verification of identity, either man or machine. In most computer security concepts, user authentication is the fundamental building block and the primary line of defense. User authentication is the basis for most types of access control and for user accountability. An authentication process mainly comprises two steps: identification step and verification step. In identification step, we are first trying to identify the entity. By presenting an identifier to the security system, an identifier should be assigned carefully because authenticated identities are the basis for other security services such as access control service. For example, you are uniquely identified in your class by your roll number. So, roll number is your identifier. Then, verification step involves presenting or generating authentication information that corroborates the binding between the entity and the identifier. Like when user enters his credentials, they are matched with the database to verify that he is the authentic user or not. What are the means of authentication? Traditionally, there are three means of authentication. First, something you know, like password or your PIN numbers. Second, something you have, like an iCard, RFID badge. And last, something you are, like biometrics. All of these methods, if properly implemented and used, can provide secure user authentication. Authentication categories. Authentication has been divided into three categories. First, what you know, which is also known as knowledge-based authentication. Second, what you have, which is also known as artifact-based authentication. And last, who you are, which is also known as biometric-based authentication. However, each category has its own problems, like an adversary may be able to guess or steal a password, or may be able to forge or steal a token, or a user may forget a password or lose a token. Further, there is a significant administrative overhead for managing password and token information on systems and securing such information on systems. With respect to biometric authenticators, there are a variety of problems, including dealing with user acceptance, cost, and convenience. Moving forward, we are now going to discuss the types of authentication. There are various techniques, or rather types, to authenticate a user. First, password-based authentication. Second, certificate-based authentication. Third, biometrics-based authentication. And last, e-token-based authentication. Let us first consider password-based authentication. In this method of authentication, the user who wants to communicate with the server has to provide its username and password to the server in order to prove his identity in the network. The ID and password of the user determine first whether the user is authorized to gain access to the system. In some systems, only those who already have an ID filed in the system are allowed to gain access. Second, the privileges accorded to the user. A few users may have, let's say, supervisory or super user status that enables them to read files and perform functions that are specially protected by the operating system. And some systems have guest or anonymous accounts, and users of these accounts have more limited privileges than others. Last is the discretionary access control. In DAC, each system object has an owner, and each initial object owner is the subject that causes its creation. Thus, an object's access policy is determined by its owner. DACs are discretionary because the subject, that is the owner, can transfer authenticated objects or information access to other users. In other words, the owner determines object access privileges. For example, by listing the IDs of the other users, a user may grant permission to them to read the files owned by that user. Let us now have a look at password-based authentication process. This figure shows how client and web server interact using password-based authentication mechanism. First, the user enters his name and password. Then the client sends name and password to the server across the network. Then web server uses password to authenticate user's identity, and web server only authorizes access for authenticated identity. So now we know password is used to authenticate users. So what are the types of passwords? The passwords can be of one of the types: plain text passwords, encrypted passwords, one-time passwords, or hashed passwords. End users type passwords, and those passwords remain visible on the screen after being typed. These are plain text passwords like ABC, XYZ. When you are typing them, they are visible on the screen. When end users type passwords and those passwords remain invisible on the screen after being typed, like you are typing ABC, but asterisk, asterisk, asterisk is visible on the screen. These are encrypted passwords. One-time passwords are the passwords that are valid for only one login session or transaction on a computer system or other digital device. You can receive an OTP on your phone or email to complete a transaction that can be used up to a limited time period only. Last are the hashed passwords. Hashing performs a one-way transformation on a password, turning the password into another string called the hash passwords. We will discuss about these in detail in later slides. Considering the fact that plain text passwords and encrypted passwords are clear to you, we are discussing one-time passwords and hashed passwords in detail. So let us first discuss about one-time passwords. One-time password is a password that is disposable and applicable for only one login session or transaction on computer system. It involves three approaches. First approach. In this, the user and the system agree upon a list of passwords. That is, if an OTP is going to give you an access to a computer system, the disposable password you hold obviously should match the password the computer has in its memory. For example, in internet banking, when you enter transaction password, at the same time, you receive an OTP in the form of SMS on your phone. So you are supposed to enter both to complete a transaction. If both matches, transaction is successful, otherwise not. Second approach. In the second approach, the user and the system agree to sequentially update the passwords, let's say on the basis of time. Example, the OTP is generated with the help of some counter, let's say starting from 001, then 002, then 003, and so on. The third approach, in this, the user and the system create a sequentially updated password using a hash function. OTPs are generated using hash function to enhance security. For example, OTPs will be generated according to the system clock. We will discuss about hash function in the coming slide. What is a hash function? A hash function is any well-defined procedure or mathematical function for turning some kind of data into a relatively small integer. It is a one-way function, that is, after converting any password into random string or fixed length, we cannot get the password again with the help of that random string. For example, let's say the password is 123@54. It is converted to a hash value like anything SDJFKDS #451 using hash function. The values returned by a hash function are called hash values, hash codes, hash sums, or simply hashes. So other than one-time passwords, we have hashed passwords. In authentication, hashing is used to create a set of numbers that represent a drive or set of files called hashed passwords. This is similar to fingerprinting someone. With hashing, a fingerprint is created from the evidence. No details about the evidence can be determined from the hash value, but if the evidence is altered in any way, the hash value will also change. Cyber forensic experts, CyberCell, use hash values to maintain the integrity of evidence collected. HashCalC, Paladin tools are used by them for this purpose. The hashing is done on the data itself and not on the names of the files. That is, if we are using hashing algorithm on any file, then the content of the file is converted into hash value. If we are changing any value, that is even a single dot, the hash value will change. We have different hashing algorithms like MD5, SHA1, SHA2, etc. With the help of these algorithms, we can calculate the hash value of any file or text. As you can see in the given figure, we have different hashing algorithms that are used to convert the text into random string of fixed length. Like you can see, we have MD5, SHA1, SHA256. We will discuss some hashing algorithms in further slides. In the given figure, the text is hello all, and using MD5 algorithm, it is converted into some hash value that you can see inside the box of string hash. Now you can see that I have appended only dot after hello all. It changes the entire hash value. In this way, we can ensure the integrity of the document. For example, suppose you need some money and you are asking to your friend for help. Your friend says that, okay, send me your account number. I'll send you money. Now you are sending your account number to your friend, and in between, the attacker modifies it and writes his account number in place of yours. Then your friend cannot identify that the account number has been changed, and by thinking that that account number is yours, he'll send the money. In these cases, we are using hashing to ensure the integrity of the message. In this figure, you can see that the hash value of hello all is different for MD5 and SHA1 because each algorithm produces different output. Due to the flaws in the existing algorithm, a new algorithm came into existence. In MD5, we have collision problem that I'll discuss in further slide. MD5 stands for Message Digest 5. The MD5 Message Digest algorithm is a widely used cryptographic hash function producing a 128-bit or 16-byte hash value, typically expressed in text format as a 32-digit hexadecimal number. It produces a fixed length output of any text or file. It is used in various cryptographic applications to ensure the integrity of the document. MD5 was designed by Ronald Rivest in 1991 to replace an earlier hash function, MD4. MD5 has been broken using collision attack. What is collision attack in MD5? Collision means finding two different input strings of a hash function that produce the same hash value. Suppose we compute the hash of some string called innocent, which computes to 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 7, 9, 8. Now, an attacker would try to find another input string generating the same hash value through some method like brute force attack. Let's say he finds another string dangerous, computes the hash, which gives the same hash value 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 7, 9, 8. This is collision attack. In simple words, there are several ways a hash collision could be exploited. If the attacker was offering a file download and showed the hash to prove the file's integrity, he could switch out the file download for a different file that had the same hash, and the person downloading it would be unable to know the difference. The file would appear valid as it has the same hash as the supposed real file. SHA-1 stands for Secure Hash Algorithm 1. After collision attack in MD5, SHA-1 was discovered. It generates 160-bit hash value. This was designed by the National Security Agency, NSA, to be part of the digital signature algorithm. Some cryptographic weaknesses were discovered in SHA-1. Also, that's why standard was no longer approved for most cryptographic users after 2010. SHA-2, Secure Hash Algorithm 2. A family of two similar hash functions with different block sizes known as SHA-256 and SHA-512. They differ in the word size. SHA-256 uses 32-bit words, while SHA-512 uses 64-bit words. There are also truncated versions of each standard known as SHA-224, SHA-384, SHA-512/224. These were also designed by the NSA. What are the uses of hashing? We can use hashing for verification, that is, it can be used to show that data object has not changed. It specifically helps the forensic experts while producing evidence in court of law. Hashing is also a way to identify and eliminate from analysis all files that contain no potential evidence, for example, software files. It is also used to identify the needle in the haystack. If known hash value may help investigator to find the one file out of thousands of other files. Hash value match for file exclusion. Examples such as operating system files. This is also known as negative hashing. Hash value match for file flagging. It is a list of hash values for known and sought out files that can be compiled and used to search for and identify files of interest to the investigator. Now, can you tell me how can passwords be protected? MD5 hashing algorithm is a one-way cryptographic function that accepts a message of any length as input and returns as output a fixed length digest value to be used for authenticating the original message, right? If we use salt along with MD5, we can protect our passwords. But what is salt? The salt serves three purposes. First, it prevents duplicate passwords from being visible in the password file. Even if two users choose the same password, those passwords will be assigned different salt values. Hence, the hashed passwords of the two users will be different. It greatly increases the difficulty of offline dictionary attacks. For a salt of length B bits, the number of possible passwords is increased by a factor of 2B, increasing the difficulty of guessing a password in a dictionary attack. It becomes nearly impossible to find out whether a person with passwords on two or more systems has used the same password on all of them. So the best way will be that a user's password is first encrypted using MD5 algorithm, then salted, and then stored. The stored password can thus never be decrypted. It will be difficult for an attacker to revert the stored password to the plain text password. The following procedure is employed, as you can see in the figure. To load a new password into the system, the user selects or is assigned a new password. This password is combined with a fixed length salt value. The password and salt serve as inputs to a hashing algorithm to produce a fixed length hash code. The hash algorithm is designed to be slow to execute thwart attacks. The hashed passwords is then stored together with plain text copy of the salt in the password file for the corresponding user ID. Benefits of password-based authentication. Passwords have been successfully providing security for systems for a long time. These are easy to manage. These are effective means to provide security when properly managed in a controlled environment. Drawbacks of password-based authentication. We can guess the password. We can get the password by shoulder surfing. If we are giving passwords to someone, he or she can misuse the password. Electronic monitoring can be done. That is, if the password is not transmitted in encrypted form, then it can be identified using network monitoring tools like Wireshark, etc. And last is accessing the password files. That is, we can access the password file using some attacks like SQL injection attack. Another